greetings to all of you, and welcome to the worship service here at the First Unitarian Church in Salt Lake City. I hope that you're all doing well following that phenomenal windstorm of biblical proportions. I hope that everyone remains safe and that the damage was not as bad as so many had feared. Hope that your debris is mostly picked up and your hair is back in place and that we can move on with our lives. I can't help but think that somehow Mother Nature was trying to tell us something, perhaps a warning. And it was such utter sadness seeing all the trees felled like corpses. I think all of us have probably mourned a little this week because of the loss of trees. I wish that all of you were actually in church right now, because those of you who know me from time to time, I like to take a straw poll. And if you were all here, I would take a straw poll and ask you, how many of you are planning to vote twice? Just raise your hands. How many are planning to vote twice? Why not? I figure, why stop at two? I think I'll try to get ballots for my parents, for my grandparents, and just keep it going. I am not, of course, recommending this. The First Unitarian Church is not proposing that we vote more than once. It is a felony. It's just some people in our country have a harder time recognizing what a felony is than some others. So that's the announcement. It's a felony. And we also have another important announcement, and that is we've got the church auction coming up right around the corner. In fact, at the end of this month, September 28th, we're going to begin the auction, and it's all going to be online. And we're going to have the silent auction beginning on the 28th and a live auction on Saturday night, October 3rd. There's more information available. I just want you to mark your calendars. Don't go anywhere October 3rd. At least, well, where do people go anyway these days? But don't go too far from your computer. Make sure you watch, participate, have fun with the church auction. Also, please, at the end of our service, we will guide you for making donations and contributions to the church, and I hope that you're able to be as generous as possible. I'd like now to light the chalice. This is a tradition, of course, that takes place in every UU church congregation across the country. And since we can't all be together, I know that a lot of our members and friends have their own chalice at home. And I'm going to invite you at this time to please light the chalice.
Symbol of light, symbol of knowledge, symbol of warmth, symbol of freedom.
We light the chalice, the symbol of our faith. Here we gather, celebrate hope and the infinite possibilities of love.
Hi, universe. It's me, Amanda. Thank you for reminding me once again that I am only in control of myself and my attitude. I have been grumpy and stressed all this week dealing with the aftermath of the windstorm. FYI, it didn't help anything and it didn't make me feel any better. So today, when the first day of school was canceled for the third time at the very last minute, I decided to start focusing my energy on loving others. I had the kids write their teachers an email thanking them, and then I sent them all coffee gift cards because no one should be going through this week without a copious amount of caffeine. Why? Their teachers are trying their very best under extraordinary circumstances. We all are. My neighbors have been wielding chainsaws in each other's yards, putting out cords for charging technology, and then texting each other complicated plans for securing house doors. We have been showing up for each other with love in little and big ways. My soul feels better when I am leading my actions with love. I wrote those words this week on my Facebook page as a reminder of how I want to show up in this world and how I want to teach my own kids how to show up in this world. Now, this does not mean that hard changes. Turns out it's pretty difficult to live in a pandemic with needed social unrest, having an earthquake, and then Category 3 hurricane winds. I cannot even say all those things out loud without shaking my head because it's all so much. But I am not in control of any of those things. I'm only in control of how I show up with love for those around me. Leading with love, care, support, and sometimes power and a cup of coffee may be the best way to show up for others. May it be so for you and yours.
There's a passage of scripture that couples often request that I include in their wedding ceremonies. Perhaps it was part of your ceremony. Even people who are not Christians love it. It's from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. And it speaks about true love, love that can stand the test of time. You probably recognize it. It goes like this. If I speak in the tongues of humans or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all that I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. The irony is that this advice on love from over 2,000 years ago was not originally intended for marrying couples. In fact, Paul believed that the world was about to end, and so he advised couples not to bother getting married if they could avoid it. No, this advice was for churches, which at that time were more like small counter-revolutionary cells than the big culturally accepted institutions that we have today. People in Paul's churches were outlaws because they refused to sacrifice to the Roman gods. And so they lived life in the shadows, maintaining goodwill with their neighbors so they wouldn't be reported to the authorities. Paul knew that a life lived this way depended on a different set of values than people were used to. And he was always looking to the ultimate counterculture figure, his hero Jesus, whose deep love for people had led him to martyrdom, as John writes in his gospel, to lay down his life for his friends. And so Paul writes to the Corinthian Jesus followers of mature love, love that could withstand stress, betrayal, and even death itself. When we look around us today at a world that groans with sighs too deep for words, when we see people dehumanizing each other so as to more easily attack and harm each other, when cruelty seems to rule the day, we read Paul's ancient advice and wonder how we can love our friends and family with this mature love, never mind our enemies. We have to remember that faith, hope, and love are choices that we make, not merely emotions that we feel. Paul is asking us to love each other even under circumstances that seem to preclude it, when we are hurt, when we are broken, when we are quite sure the other person doesn't deserve it. Love never takes the easy way out. Love always stays in the game. Today, during our worship, we are meditating on Jesus' command to love one another. As you go through your week, I invite you to meditate on these words of Paul as well. Pray for the strength to love your fellow human beings in a deeper way, and for the discernment to know what that means. Search your heart for the courage to love better and to accept love when it comes your way. I haven't given up on love that can change the world. Don't you give up either.
An image that most of us will probably carry for a very long time, if not for a lifetime. An image so provocative in these times, marked by a divide, separation of people with such utter hatred, with gun culture on the one side and justice seekers on the other. An image that virtually comes so close to striking a match on a keg of dynamite ready to blow up the country at this very difficult point in time. Now, this image floated into everyone's awareness not long ago when our nation's president had security clear the walkway of peaceful protesters, clear the walkway by very violent means so that the president could walk from the White House to St. John's Episcopal Church. And once there, the president held up a Bible upside down and then proceeded back to the White House carrying the Bible most uncomfortably, as though it were smeared with fungus. Now, obviously, this bizarre behavior expressed something symbolic to his base, comprised to a large extent of evangelical Christians. But what was it? What was his message? Was it code, perhaps, for God is really a white supremacist? Was he pretending to be an authority on the Bible? I mean, can't you just hear him explaining, for example, the book of Exodus, when Pharaoh's army pursued the Jews? I mean, can't you just hear him say, oh, you know, there are good people on both sides. But whatever the intended message, he should have consulted with somebody a little more knowledgeable about religious things before posing in front of St. John's Church. St. John's, wow. The church was named for Jesus' disciple, whom we get to know very well in the Gospel according to John. John distinguished himself from Mark, Matthew, and Luke by focusing not on what Jesus did, but he focused instead on who Jesus was. Now, according to John, Jesus was all about demonstrating to the world how best we understand how to express God's love. The point being, we were placed on this earth exclusively for the purpose of carrying out God's love. Jesus' most famous message, probably found anywhere in the Bible, was expressed in John when he instructed his disciples to love one another. A new commandment I give, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know you are my disciples if you love one another. Now, for some inexplicable reason, I always want to add right now. Love one another right now. Come on, people, now smile on your brother. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. I'm sure if Jesus had thought of it, he would have added the tag right now, but it just didn't come to him. But either way, that passage does not call for a fade out and then suddenly switching to beating up protesters and firing tear gas and spraying them with rubber bullets. Now, to love one another is the only commandment Jesus gives in the entire gospel. And it means, quite simply, through love, we do the work of God. Healing, bringing about peace, establishing justice. But here we are in the year 2020. And so I might ask, what does it mean, really, to love one another these days? Given the obscene disparities in income, wealth, and health, and the law applied according to the color of one's skin, it sure doesn't feel like there's much love or smiles even upon our brothers. So it's hard to come up with a working definition of what does it really mean today to love one another. I've tried a million ways, and the best that I have come up with in these harsh and callous times, to love one another means a devotion to the welfare of others. A devotion to the welfare of others. But there's a caveat. In order to devote one's life to the welfare of others, we must escape the irresistible trappings of our own self-concern. Philanthropy must replace egotism. Now, philanthropy in the very classic sense, does not mean giving a large bequest to a charity. In its purest definition, it means other-directedness, other-directed. Now, biblically, it represents selfless love. It is only through selfless love, philanthropy, selfless love, that we can begin to transform the world. Now, there's been a lot of talk of late, especially after the summer, about transforming the world. We're on our way, we're going to get it, but you know we're going to get nowhere unless we are less preoccupied with ourselves and we show real concern for the others, that we become more other-directed. Without that, there's going to be no transformation of the world. Selfless love these days seems to be in short supply. Well, perhaps it's always been. Much like our Unitarian Universalist theological foundations for our pursuit of justice, we boast that we are on the side of love. That's our mantra. Every injustice must be confronted from the angle of love. And we have the banners and the songs, but when you get right down to it, are we progressives fully prepared to devote our lives to the welfare of others? And what is our interpretation of selfless love? What does it mean to you, selfless love? I wrestle with it all the time myself. What are you prepared to sacrifice, give up, let go, instead of pursuing your own advancement in society? Now, being other-directed or philanthropic colors our own moral sensibilities, doesn't it? But frankly, it's hard to get a beat on it. The concept of loving one another is disputed not only by, you know, irrational people, by white supremacists, the base of the president, but it's also disputed by science, evolutionary biologists in particular. Now, they say that sacrificing for the benefit of others with no reward for oneself is biologically impossible. Wow. You know, apparently then, to love one another in a way the disciples were commanded to, this business of loving one another runs completely counter to this innate genetic drive to survive. Because the theory is that if we help the other guy, we would decrease the chances of making it in this world ourselves. You know, scientists will say, you know, humans just don't go there. It would lead to our own extinction. So trying to put this in a nutshell, helping behavior is ruled out because it's antithetical to our own survival. Of course, they allow that we may fool ourselves into thinking otherwise, but we cannot, bottom line, we cannot help being selfish. The fact is, biologists say that even Jesus was selfish because his motive was to have others believe that he was working for God. And this would, of course, benefit him. So Jesus was really selfish in all that he did in his ministry. I'd say Darwin was right. It's all about survival of the fittest. And we simply cannot deny the science that supports that. So I'm trying to get this image of all of us being this conglomerate of selfish genes in order that we can survive. And we are somehow programmed to give the next generation the best that we have. Altruism, meaning other-directed behavior, enhances the survivability and fitness of someone else, which, of course, only undermines me. So what are the implications, then, for what motivates us? You know, how do we place morality in the context of this particular scheme? Evolutionary biologists contend there's no such thing as selfless love. We make decisions based on our own best chances of survival. And that's why evolutionary biologists, Richard Dawkins, chiefly among them, find religion quite expendable. Ooh, expendable? I don't want to sound defensive. I mean, I've just been in this business for 45 years. I'd like to think, I think I may be somewhat right, standing somewhat on firm ground, that there's enough free agency to determine how we want to live our lives despite our genetic inclinations. I mean, we are forced to make moral decisions all the time, aren't we? I mean, just think about it. What's going on right now in our world today, in this country? You know, eliminating health care for the poor. Keeping people of color away from the corridors of power. These are conscious decisions. From a religious perspective, well, yeah, we can agree that a basic survival instinct exists. No problem. But other-directed human behavior can also point to a cooperative model of survivability. When philanthropy is reciprocal, when there's a give and take, we increase the survivability of everyone, don't we? That's a plausible idea. Now, a progressive theology begins with the premise that we solely exist in relations to others. We exist in relation to others. And only by strengthening our relations with others do we have a chance of surviving in the great scheme of things. Now, to make this more clear, we have the political ethicist Kristen Renwick Monroe to help us kind of imagine all this. If you don't know Kristen Monroe, she is amazing. A political ethicist always makes me laugh. It's an oxymoron these days to be a political ethicist. But most of her work took place at UC Irvine. She is currently, I believe, working on some research in Radcliffe, and she has really hit the top of the charts in terms of research is as a political ethicist. What she does so effectively is move us away from binary thinking by conceptualizing a continuum. So imagine this continuum with pure altruism on one end of the extreme and pure self-interest on the other end. So you got this spectrum, okay, this continuum. It's not an either-or situation. And what she does is offer examples of pure altruistic behavior. I find this very helpful. She talks about those who place themselves and their families at risk to help others that offered no possibility of reward back to them. She's referring to people who hid Jews from Nazi persecution. Many rescuers housed Jews for months, sometimes even years at a time. And if these rescuers were discovered by Nazis, well, they would be imprisoned and likely executed. The rescuers received nothing in exchange for hiding Jews, not even a scrap of bread. The act of helping was an end in itself. There was no incentive to assist Jews, in fact, a tremendous incentive not to. So in Kristen Munro's research, attempting to discover how these extreme altruists were different from the rest of the population, she found only one distinctive difference. And I quote, "Altruists see the world as one in which connections exist among people, which even extends through all of nature. Because of this, altruists act without regard for consequences, and even said that they felt they had to act. They felt linked to humankind as a whole." End of quote. They had to act. Now, this profound connection to others is obviously what the conservative right lacks. They consistently argue that in a fierce world, the less we feel responsible for others, the more that we have a chance then to flourish ourselves. And if care is extended to include, my goodness, the wider ecology of the world, well, we can see then how this becomes anathema for those who refuse to appreciate the interconnectedness of us all. In other words, the sage grouse gets no love, not from the right, no love. But imagine placing morality on this continuum. It would eliminate judgments as to who's moral or not. It's not an either or. You've got this enormous spectrum, all right? It would end discussion on morality as, conceivable situations where you say, well, I'm moral, you're not. Impossible. Because there's this spectrum. Now, using Kristen Munro's model, we would place extreme selfishness on one end and willingness to make huge sacrifices for the welfare of others on the other end. But then it becomes interesting. We may all agree with the need to love one another, but we won't all agree as to where to place that command, where to place ourselves on this continuum. So this is when true moral self-examination begins. So you're looking at the continuum and you wonder, how much of my life am I concerned mostly about myself? How much am I willing to sacrifice for others? So where do I place myself on this continuum? A little on the selfish side? A little on the sacrifice side, a lot on the sacrifice side. More selfish than perhaps we'd like to admit ourselves. So that becomes an unbelievably difficult and yet worthwhile practice for us to examine ourselves, placing ourselves on this continuum. Then, of course, we also need to ask, do I love those who are not part of my tribe? You know, of course, we like to think ourselves as moral beings. It would be terrible not to. I mean, you know, I never walk up to somebody and say, "Hi, my name is Tom. I'm not very moral." No, that doesn't happen. Of course, I think I'm moral, and you do the same. But it's that spectrum. It's not an either or, but where do I see myself on the spectrum? Scripture is filled with remarkable stories. In the Gospel of John, we hear the story of love one another. And this is part of the grand story that proclaims that eternal love exists in the universe, and we need to share in it and participate in this love that abounds. Now, it's just a story, but it speaks to us, doesn't it? It asks, what kind of expectations do we have of ourselves? And that's what religion is all about. Religion poses these questions to help define ourselves as best we can. Now, do you think our president realized that when he stood in front of St. John's Church with the Bible upside down? What do you think? As we extinguish the chalice, may we contemplate what an odd command it is to love one another, especially in times like these. But then again, perhaps it was always difficult to love one another. Sacrifice of some kind is unavoidable when you devote your life to the welfare of others. Now, is that asking too much of ourselves? Maybe. But perhaps that's why the command to love one another holds such a sacred place in Scripture. It's a pretty lofty idea. But you know, it's really not impossible. So take a moment to Imagine the world where all are loved, even in times like these. Amen.